everybody that starts at the same level. And once you go through the basics of the slides, and Tom and I will talk about implementation and other security issues of LDAP. Talk about what is LDAP, why do we need LDAP, who uses it, exactly what are the potential dangers, and methods of attacks. LDAP itself is not blatantly insecure, it's just the way it's being implemented is insecure. Anybody here familiar with the fun we had with YP in the 80s? You know, download anybody's information system, YP is all, it's nice distributed database, quote. Crackers are just downloading your password files over the internet, no restrictions. Similar things happen with LDAP due to people's laziness and the way they set it up. And what we try to do in this talk is convince you to actually implement LDAP correctly, give you an idea of what needs to be done. So, as we go along, what is LDAP?
So that's a big advantage right there. Where's the next slide? Yeah, directory is essentially a database, but tends to contain more descriptive, attribute-based information. The information in LDAP directory tends to be read more than is written, so LDAP is designed to be more read-optimized and not write-optimized. So I ripped directly from the slide. How exciting. LDAP directory service model is based on entries, basically entries collecting attributes. It starts with a DN, which is, for example, UID equals Tom, then the OU organizational unit, then the O or the organization. So UID equals Tom, OU equals people, O equals messaging, for example. Then the RDN comes in play as pretty much the leftmost attribute, which is UID equals Tom. That's how it pretty much works. A DN is pretty much used to refer to the entry unambiguously. So the entries have to be unique, pretty much simple database thing. Each of the entries attributes has a type and one or more values. The types are typically strings like CM for common name, mail for email address, mail host for the mail host. So you basically have the DN at the very top. Underneath the DN, you have a whole set of attributes. Whenever you reference the DN, you can have to return any of the number of attributes that are listed underneath the entry. Okay, so what operating system supports it? It comes with source, so everything supports it. Netscape supported under Linux, Solaris, HPUX, everything else is pretty much one of the main, actually the best directory out there is Netscape directory server. There's open LDAP as well, and all those good things.
And as points out here, Microsoft and IBM announced recently to jump into the whole LDAP system. Microsoft is, even the FreeBSD community has an entire LDAP project going where we're going to LDAP enable the entire FreeBSD distribution. We have other things. Microsoft, anybody here work with Win 2000 yet? Registry and Active Directory are becoming almost the same thing. We can actually access your Active Directory, which is their version of LDAP, just a different schema. Whether through the file system, through the registry, or even through simple Active Directory clients. Now, not only a lot of servers out there, but a lot of applications for LDAP enabled. Qmail, for example, is available. You have SendMail to be available. LDAP enabled basically means that you're capable of doing queries into LDAP. Your Sun, the next version, is going to have, you're familiar with the NS switch comp. That's where you tell it to use YP or use password file. You also have a new directive called LDAP. So now you can actually tell a few host lookups via LDAP, or even username lookups is switchable, configurable. That's becoming into base operating system. Here's some examples here. We have Netscape messaging server, basically anything by Netscape. We've got, mostly Tom stuff here, but Tom knows too much about the sendmail part. I've worked a lot with Active Directory implementations for ISPs where we're uploading server is a thin client that receives LDAP queries and well, actually receives a radius query from legacy hardware and forms an LDAP query to your centralized server.
I guess the reason people are using LDAP right now is because they want to centralize information. That's pretty much coming from the scalability area. I'm a security person, I'm a scalability architect guy. And if you have LDAP, you can pretty much have one centralized server storing all the entries, optimized for nice reads, and you can replicate the information all across. So you don't have to rely on a single password file or any configuration file on localhost. It's all done through a remote database. So it's a big advantage. Okay, what are people using LDAP for? Personal directory services, mail routing, login password authentication. I guess some's going to be doing NSSwitch.com is going to be supporting all that. PKI, IP address distribution. Basically anything that also requires scalability, that requires centralized information. And it's going to be pretty much a lot of people wanting to be replacement with DNS, but that's probably not going to happen if DNS actually works as opposed to everything else here. So
actually, I could jump that part a little bit. One of the things using LDAP for is I can subdomains are using LDAP as backends. This way, when you're logging to your ISP, automatically your reverse lookup automatically is associated. So my name is Shipley. If I dial up into some ISP, for example, my reverse DNS becomes shipley.dialup.server. And this is done because there's a backend to the bind server which ties into the LDAP server. DHCP is a good, there's thin client, there's thin DHCP clients, where instead of maintaining a little DBM server, it actually maintains an LDAP entry when you do your DHCP. So when I get assigned an address, it goes to a centralized database for your LDAP. This is advantageous, for large scale ISPs, because now we can actually use this as a locking mechanism to stop multiple people from dialing in. And you do user tracking this way. What scares me most on this slide, by the way, is the fourth one, PKI. It's difficult, but when I was at RSA conference, every vendor I talked to offering PKI solutions was using LDAP as a foundation. Yes. Oh, she said because of the scalability, that's why I confirmed. What was that? We're going to get into that in a minute, but the majority of LDAP servers I found open on the internet are wide open. People are using simple passwords, while this upcoming slide talks about that. But it's basically the user laziness. People get it working, they don't put on the safety belts. Well, again, because it's centralized push, don't be surprised, nearly every network application becomes LDAP enabled. Again, this is an eggs in one basket problem.
Companies like Motorola and Intel, they actually used to have these big DAP systems there. We're going to LDAP right now, and HR runs on LDAP. The badging system runs on LDAP. Your salary runs on LDAP. Everything known to man runs on LDAP within those systems. And these are the same companies that that have no idea what they're doing with the security. So it's pretty scary. So you got these vulnerable machines running on Spark 10s, controlling the entire system. Using LDAP without any authentication because they don't know how to use SSL there. They don't know how to do anything there. It's pretty scary.
I mean, if you pull out the menus on your Netscape mail client or your Outlook program, it ties into your local LDAP server to look up usernames, track down people's phone numbers. Why? I don't like it takes so much basket ideas. You know, too much problems. I mean, yeah, you're multiple replicated databases and such, but I don't like the idea of eggs in one basket. If one server goes down, we've all been out of sight where the DNS went down. And what was connectivity after that? Yeah, it didn't exist. Why? Because it couldn't do any resolving. New untested technology. I personally feel too many companies are investing too much too quickly in user technology. I could probably get my ass chewed up by my boss since KPMG is a major LDAP player. But this is personally one of my, as a security person, it's my job to say these things. You have a lot of inexperienced administrators and contractors doing this. If you find somebody who knows what they're talking about. You know, I personally, ground zero, I helped write some of the code in Active Directory. This guy is limited to servers larger.
It's still West Coast. Palm 7 was released. It's a really large LDAP enabled messaging system, and that's one I helped design just recently over the past couple years. You've got basically inexperienced administrators up there running these systems, kind of like, people like from Netscape, they charge, professional services charges $225 an hour to walk in there and play with your LDAP settings. And half the bugs, I mean, I filed hundreds and hundreds of bugs against the directory server, and to get them resolved, it cost me $225 an hour. You don't find cheap people who know LDAP because it's pretty much a new technology out there. So you've got to hire people like me for $224 an hour to save some money. So, woohoo!
I also find a lot of contractors come in and try to get the server working and get out of there. So they rely on using the inefficient security. You didn't give them the hours to set up a Kerberos server, so they're going to walk in and out with simple passwords. We'll talk about that in a minute. Again, I want to reiterate here, history is repeating itself. YP came out, everybody jumped on the YP bandwagon, now called NAS, and everybody got their password file stolen, fed through crack, and broken into. I don't want to see this happening again. Actually, yeah, same thing, registry. Everybody's jumping on NT. You know you can edit registry remotely? Why is it dangerous? Let's reiterate ourselves. DAPing a lot of places, insecure, poorly coded conversion systems. This is DAP to LDAP gateways. I also mentioned DNS gateways, radius gateways, TAC access gateways, all of which are out there. Your radius server, again, is being replaced by lightweight, thin clients. Your TAC access server is being replaced by a lightweight, thin client that does simply nothing but translate the queries. Default permissions. Tom will talk about this more in a few slides. It's ugly. Single control. Yeah, I love this. People are like, oh, we have backups on our system. Well, what if I root your server? You know, instead of using a DBM server, maybe you have some Oracle backends and certain servers. Well, sometimes it's one big ASCII file. That's kind of easy to edit.
And actually, most of the DAP to LDAP gateways people are using are based around FTP.
It's a code exploit. I assume everybody here subscribed to bug tracks. And if you do a search on bug tracks, you see there's already five nice little bucket overflows in Microsoft code. Trust this? DOS attacks. It is simple denial of service attacks. You know, okay, just because you're a really fast server, does that mean, I can flood your system with simple queries, and your users then cannot log in? Why? Because your server's too busy with my non-existent queries. Same thing, I can flood you with expensive queries, your server's too busy doing DBM writes, and God forbid if you support writes under anonymous connections. Your server's toast. And people typically, again, I reiterate this again, servers only run as they get it. The service is only as secure as you set it up. People don't use real security. Usually, I find the majority of LDAP servers I have seen on the internet use simple, unencrypted connections with simple passwords, no site certificates. You know, what are the dangers? Anybody like spam? Anybody? But why are you putting your password and your email list available for an internet download? Data harvesting. Headhunters love getting your clientele. And the companies love connecting to find out all your employees, offering better jobs. Well, let's put them on the internet so people can download them. System crackers are harvesting account names, emails. Typically, your email, your POP password, stored in LDAP, unencrypted. Crackers are basically doing bulk data downloads with your login name, your password, even if it is encrypted. A lot of times it's used standard Unix encryption, feed it to crack, 2 hours later I'm in. If you pay me, I will break in with a PO order. Data modification. This is a fun one. You know, everybody says, oh, I run ISS, or I run Ballista, or whatever product you're using, I run Satan, I run Satan too. This is new technology. None of them really test for this yet. I'm sure the representatives of those companies are going to run off and make announcements they're going to support it next week. Good. That's why I said that. But currently, there are no automated data integrity testing. There are no automated scripts that go through your LDAP system, go through your LDAP tree, and verify your proper ACLs on all in your schema. This is something that needs to be done manually. So people that rely on automated security, you're SOL. Commercial products just don't exist. I don't have any free ones either. So, maybe I'll write one. Okay, how do we find you? We all know NMAP, Strobe will do it too. So it's NMAP. This is the LDAP and the secure LDAP ports. It's for a nice little IP address. I don't have to worry about it. But we just run this, within 2 or 3 minutes, you'll have all the LDAP servers for that network. I can run this against a Class B. I think I ran it across the Class B. It took me, less than a day. scan entire Class B looking for LDAP servers. I mean, mind you, I was out drinking coffee, bicycling around Berkeley, and my machine just crank along, find the servers for me. Run a second script, do the data harvesting. Firewalls does not protect these things. The best thing for you to do is to look for these logs. I didn't get one phone call when I scanned several Class Bs for LDAP servers. Something's wrong here. DNS. Everybody familiar with RFC 2052? That's one of those nights I think Paul Dixie was drinking too much coffee. But he has this idea of moving the services record into DNS. Now, a lot of people, especially the Active Directory people, are using this. So we set up a SVR record, and you actually set up a subdomain called TCP. And so we have LDAP, for example, you have like telnet, or login.tcp.netcom.com. And in theory, my rlogin program should now do a lookup for that, and you have a server record which points to a port number and IP address to find that resource. So instead of, you know, right now we use, for example, CNAMEs. We'll CNAME mail.domain.com as a pointer, and then they change the CNAME to where it's supposed to go. This is actually a server record where you actually do a look. You do a lookup of mail.com, and you have a reference pointing towards the mail server's IP address and the port send mail runs on. Because it's kind of stupid that we have a distributed name system and a static file for services. This is sort of the extension. But back to LDAP, I did a scan for this, and a lot of people jump on the LDAP bandwagon are implementing this RFC. So I just do a zone transfer. I don't have to do a zone transfer. I just query for LDAP.domain and LDAP.tcp.domain, and I get these hits telling me that, yes, we're there. Now, I'm not telling you not to use this RFC, but I'm just trying to point out, don't think you have an LDAP server that I'm not going to find it. I get hired to do professional security audits, that's why I say I get hired to find these things. This is how we find it. So security through obscurity is not security. Because you have an LDAP server in your demilitary zone and you don't have it, and you don't have anything pointing towards it, you're still gonna find it. Companies using name services purpose, RFC, blah blah blah. Referrals, is a fun one. We all love AltaVista. AltaVista, you do plus link colon, and then you specify part of the URL, say link colon you and like LDAP. And you get all, since Netscape and actually, you know, all the browsers these days support LDAP queries, people are linking to LDAP in their web pages. How am I going to find your server? Easy. I do a web search looking for URLs with LDAP. So the FTP colon or HTTP colon, we have LDAP colon. All to this one, give me a whole list of them, no problem. I can write a file tree bot that looks for these things, web switches, URL links, it's easy stuff. How bad is it? Random survey. Most sites on the internet were found to be wide open. Wide open, that is not, maybe I could get the entire database, but there really is too much stuff available. I shouldn't be able to download your usernames at least. I mean, I couldn't download some of the medium secure sites. I couldn't download your passwords, but I was able to get your information and get usernames. If I was a spammer, that's enough. Most servers allow anonymous. Anonymous is effectively non-authentication. If you connect up to an LDAP server and do not authenticate yourself, it's considered an anonymous connection. LDAP-enabled sites, I found a large number, did not utilize SSL secure connections. They use simple passwords. That being, you know, a clear text connection where you transmit a static string as a password. Now, who here uses SSH? Why? Because we don't want our password stolen in clear text. So why are we putting some more important information up in clear text download? Yeah. High transaction speeds, even if you're using SSL, let's use an SSL with simple passwords. So okay, I can't sniff your password, but your server does 10,000 queries a second? That's 10,000 password attempts a second. How big's your dictionary? That's barely crack. Password running. Data found, a lot of email addresses, we talked about that, usernames, semi-personal, home, phone numbers, if I can sell this information to a recruiter. Employee status, encrypted login passwords, I can find out, your manager names, where you are in the company, stuff that shouldn't be available. Also, maybe you're not too worried, but if someone could download this personal information from your company, what are legal aspects that you have this information available for download? Suit for leaking information on the internet? What can be done? Strong authentication? dedicate a server, I recommend that. One thing I hate when I do security audits is these people who have this one Uber server, this, you know, umpteen processor Super Spark. And they've got their mail server, they got their DNS, they got everything on this thing. Oh yeah, Ultra Spark. I mean, what is this? Yeah, stupidity. I mean, go out, buy a server for each one. You know, on your mail server, delete the FTP daemon. Don't comment it out, just delete that daemon. You know, delete some of the login stuff. Have each server have a separate purpose. Why are you running sendmail on your DNS server? Delete sendmail. Don't turn it off. Delete it. So, just quick follow-up here. They'll give more detail. These are types of authentication available.
Okay, yeah, anonymous authentication, which is pretty much the default. Say by default, you're allowed to connect anonymously and get about 500 or 2,000 records. Some of the pieces of software out there that actually, some of the applications out there that actually, some of the applications out there that actually require LDAP and anonymous logins. The administrators actually increased the limit from 500 to 2,000 to infinite, because you search on object class equals star, it's going to return more than 2,000 entries, but you can parse them as well. Simple passwords, which is what most people use. SSL simple passwords, SSL certificates, and caberos. So happy. And okay. Anonymous is basically anonymous, no authentication whatsoever. You can get pretty much everything anonymous. Okay. Simple passwords uses simple passwords. This is pretty much the most, it's very, very insecure, as we all know from earlier. Let's go to the next one. SSL simple passwords. This authentication method relies on the use of simple passwords over a securely encrypted link. This is the most secure authentication method, but it's also simple to attack with brute force methods. Okay. I don't know what to say on these ones in particular. Let's just go on to the next one. The minimum requirement for Netscape is ultra class machine. It has to be 4U. So an ultra one connection, servers 10,000 queries a second or something. Certificates actually support SSL certificates in certain implementations of LDAP for most things. The problem is you get LDAP servers communicate LDAP servers for replication, and sometimes it doesn't even work with SSL. Actually, replication itself actually sucks under Netscape. So half the time you're actually going to do them the simplest setup. Because it breaks all the time and requires a $225 consultant to get it working properly for more than a week and a half of the time. So people actually don't bother with SSL or SSL with any way whatsoever with it, because it's just one more layer of abstraction right there. Oh yeah. Again, Kubernetes is really good based. Complex, that's also, once again, not supported with most things. I mean, everything supports anonymous notifications or simple passwords. A few things are supporting SSL, Kubernetes, whatever. So.
Active Directory supports Kerberos, and everybody else announced they're going to be using Kerberos. But unfortunately, Kerberos is a bear to set up. So a lot of people avoid setting up Kerberos. They don't want to take a big jump. Plus, they run the Kerberos server and the DNS server. I don't know why. And yeah, it's the worst thing you could possibly do in Kerberos, because it's not a Kerberos lecture. And what happens is people bother setting up Kerberos, so they end up using simple text, because SSL doesn't work anywhere. In addition, with SSL, if you buy into an external site, basically, you want SSL, you want to have multiple SSL servers. But that means you have to buy into somebody else's certificate system, which means it's going to cost you extra money, extra PO. I mean, yeah, $100 for a certificate or something like that, is chump change. But it's the PO of getting your boss to sign something to get the certificate. I mean, it's actually several hundred dollars if you want to include my time to fill out the paperwork. So people don't bother getting certificates for each server. And I will just go clear text. It's internal anyway. And just because it's internal, with FBI statistic, 85% of break-ins come from the inside. So, apples. Have fun.
Okay, ACLs under within LDAP are actually not a standard. Everyone actually has their own little way of doing it. Netscape's actually leading the way right now. They have their own little strange ACL thing, which I think we've demonstrated on the next slide. I'm sure hopefully how we do it. Yes, woohoo! Okay, that's basically what Netscape ACL looks like off of a piece of paper when I was doing it. So I'm not sure exactly how perfectly things are there. Basically, you got the target, which is a directory server, UPT, ORG, this is mine. The address, which is pretty much what attributes you want to detect or do any sort of change on, was version 3 in the ACL. And you can allow it for a read, search, compare, for example. And the user DN is anyone. For example, you can have it so that the user DN, you can set it up to where, in order to get certain attributes, you need a password, or need to bind as the person, which is the self attribute, or you bind as directory manager, or require some other form of authentication. There's also target filter above the target ATTR up there, but I didn't put that one in there because I didn't. So, okay. Happy. ACL is pretty much what we just talked about in the previous slide. You can protect objects in there. You can make it so that a certain, you can do based on host or application. For example, you can make it so that only the mail server can grab the mail host attribute or something like that. Access rights, you can control read rights, search, compare, etc. So we're walking back and forth to make our slides and our presentation a little bit longer. It's really not that long. Okay, we require, say, for example, we can require the use of passwords or passwords of SSL or certificates of SSL in order to obtain certain attributes, like we said before. Unfortunately, once again, it's not a standard anywhere whatsoever and probably won't be one, and Netscape's implementation is a little bit weird. References, understanding deploying LDAP directory services, LDAP programming. There's also another one out there called deploying LDAP, I think. It's the Red Book. It's pretty good. So is it on the next slide?
Sure.
I don't think it just came out recently. It's actually a pretty good book. The first one's actually my favorite. And more references online. Happy. Woohoo.
The fun chicken and the egg. A lot of certificates being referred to here are your public private key certificates. That's your personal certificate, which is typically stored, for example, in your Netscape client. You type in your password or decrypt your certificate and use that to connect to the LDAP server. The PKI, typically certificate servers of that type, are where I try to verify your public key of your certificate. So that doesn't quite apply to your question is. Typically, people maintain their private key of the certificate on their disk, and that is used as the authentication to the server. What's usually being served with PKI is usually more of a public key distribution method. Next.
From the applications themselves, like with Netscape Enterprise Server, as far as I know, if you take away anonymous access, your Enterprise Server will break because it binds to do searches when you try to authenticate. Also, the password policies in LDAP, as far as I know, directory server are totally broken. Well, the options are there, but they're unusable.
Yeah.
They'll time out passwords without warning users, and you can't get them to change them.
Yeah.
So,
that's one of the deficiencies in that. We find a lot of times that, let me point out, just because you place SSL in something, this is a pet peeve of mine. I love all these websites that says, we're secure because we use SSL. All that means is I can't steal your password away to the server. Once my credit card's on that server, it's still secure? No. That's one of my pet peeves. And that's one of the things I'm seeing being applied to this. When you're using simple password SSL, wrong. I mean, that just stops the passive sniffer attacks. Doesn't mean I can't crack your passwords or grind them.
search for that on Los Angeles DNS. Aren't those both highly vulnerable to burglar alarm defenses?
Yeah, but people don't look for it. Most burglar alarms or IDSs out there are going to look for login connections, RPC connections, ARSH connections. They're not quite looking for just one random port. Yeah, you can easily write one, it'd be trivial to add to it. I could also do various thin, you know, I could do half duplex connections, you know, send the thin. There's several types of ways to store them. Yeah, you can detect these things, but, you know, if you get one thin packet to one port ever in your lifetime, you're going to ring the alarm for that? Probably not. I mean, you don't want to be, you don't want an IDS that trigger, that rings bells every time you get a stray packet.
If you're doing it on the LDAP ports and you have it across several workstations, why would anyone be scanning? Anyone who's not doing port scanning for LDAP servers, you know, why would they ring all simultaneously? So I mean, if you put it on multiple nodes on a user base rather than on servers, a good chance you'd probably catch all the port scans, and those wouldn't trip. Except when someone was actually trying to actively search for it.
Yeah. I agree IDS will help, but I just scanned the entire Pacific Rim for web servers, and I only got two phone calls, but I scanned entire Class A. So what you're saying, yeah, IDSs will detect it, yes, but who runs it and who actually follows up on it? I have lists and lists of NCSA version 09 web servers. Very, very insecure servers. I mean, I've tempted to write to these people, can I have a copy of that server? I lost my copy, you know, 4 years ago. But no, I didn't get, you know, like with one or two phone calls, maybe. So yes, IDS can help, but who bothers? It's, you know, one thing I discovered by doing security for the last 15 years is that people are lazy. Yes, there's lots of applications to secure things, but people are lazy. Questions?
As we start seeing more of these PKI vendors using the LDAP services to reach out to the internet or to exchange between different sites. What is your feeling about basically having to have your LDAP be exposed to the internet and, you know, have multiple LDAP servers? Do you have any comments on that?
This falls, this typically falls under the concept of how to run proper DNS. A proper, I mean, a large site, a proper DNS configuration would be an internal and an external server. You have the external tables, which basically there's maybe the firewalls listed, a couple IP addresses. And you have your internal, which name the workstations. Same thing with LDAP. You want your external, internal. A lot of times you want LDAP, people actually want, you know, you want people to be able to look up your information. There are more and more LDAP gateway servers, the CGIs running. So instead of maintaining the web page for contacts, why don't we just have our web page be LDAP enabled to query our internal database and find Shipley's current phone number. And that's where you're going to find, so you got these gateways that will be filtering. But if you're actually going to expose an external LDAP server, I recommend you actually run a separate server, separate data. Same thing with Oracle databases. I'll pick on Oracle's, you know, any major database. I personally believe that you should run separate ones, but more companies I wish to name have everything in one database and just rely on the database ACLs. Well, I don't know any extreme exploits directly against those ACLs. I don't like the ideas. Eggs in a basket, run two servers. Same thing with LDAP. Run two servers. What's it going to cost you versus what's the fix? I mean, buy another Ultra, replicate the machine, clean up the database, you're done. It's a lot cheaper than a break-in. Next. I'm talking about that complete. Are you missing somebody? Ah. I don't think my mic cord can reach you, but... He's asking about if they don't have any external proxies. I personally don't know of any. He's saying he recommends using ACLs. I don't know of any actual proxy systems that actually do filtering. But at the same time, that's a big weakness in the proxy, in the whole proxy market. I'm still looking for a good SQL filter. I'm yet to find one. And this one, it might be a kind of hard thing to write, actually. Yes, it all depends. Questions? We purposely left a good 20 minutes of, like, Q&A here. Hobbit.
Is there a source for LDAP protocol?
Yes. If you download, if you, you understand Open LDAP come with some shell level query utilities. I recommend you use it on X-Window so you can cut and paste your queries a lot. But yeah, it's there. The UMISH comes with one, and the Open LDAP come with one. I think it's the name of it. Yeah, LDAP search is one. There's a few others.
Standard LDAP search. Yeah, the standard is LDAP search between all of them, pretty much. Same command line arguments. Yeah, you can use Perl DAP if you want to, which is pretty nice.
Is that the directory Perl?
Woohoo. Have you actually tried getting Netscape to Netscape replication working properly? You know, let alone like X500 replication to, you know, this build LDAP server?
Yeah.
DAP to DAP, but yeah, but I mean, you know, DAP to LDAP is, I mean, Netscape can't even support you Netscape to Netscape, you know, replication properly. So doing anything other than their own product, replication between the two is going to be like pretty much impossible. So you know, a lot of people take out SSL out of there and use plain text replication between them because it's just impossible to get it working properly. And everything's changed as far as implementation. Like Netscape version 4 came out really just recently, and it's totally different than Netscape version 3 for replication and all that, so not many people know how to do it yet. Questions on email scalability and LDAP? Yeah, I have no idea who's there. Yeah, developer on Netscape.com has a lot of a lot of documentation that's really, really good, actually. It's not very consistent when it comes to some of the high-end features. In order to get replication working, you kind of have to go through like 20 different documents, and each one says to do it a different way. Which is why Netscape is making money still. Oh, come on. Please, ask really simple questions. Yep. So you really should use LDAP, because it's, I mean, it's, I mean, LDAP is a good protocol. I mean, I really don't know how to address that part of it. I mean, it's a brand new protocol out there that works, and it's going to become a big standard right now that everyone's buying into it. So if you actually want some sort of like an open protocol to use between, you know, yourself and everybody else, you really should maybe go to LDAP.
Other under recommendations, we'll put SSH. When I was Nintendo, actually, and a few other, I was actually from the company, they had a problem with that Oracle going, they wanted secure Oracle transfers, they wanted to pay the big license fee for the encrypted link. So what they used was SSH tunnels to do the TCP connections to transfer the data. As a solution, until people finally fix SSL with LDAP, you might want to consider just setting up encrypted tunnels. For example, SSH will work really nicely, binding local ports to foreign ports. You'll be able to do your replications through an SSH tunnel. I recommend that until they fix the SSL. Yes. The idea of LDAP is lightweight. Version 1 and 2 are lightweight, and version 3 is heavyweight. When I first saw LDAP, I was like, I'll just buy an Oracle server. But I really don't know the exact reasons for that.
Actually, during the default Netscape installation, there are about 17,000 lines of garbage in the first part of the directory. I mean, it's pretty much everything imaginable stored in LDAP right now. If your LDAP directory goes down, your entire Netscape sweet spot servers go down, pretty much. So it's pretty scary. And there's no real way of making it so that you can actually replicate the data properly, because the implementation is bad.
One of my pet peeves I can touch upon is the damn schema. Everybody's got their own name for everything. what the values inside your LDAP server. You know, is it username or name or person's name? You know, what's the name of the attribute? Well, because everybody has their own schema. I mean, the Microsoft schema, I think in 10-point double pages like this thick, literally. And one of the big things is how are you going to maintain security across multiple platforms that everybody's got a different name for different attributes? I mean, you have a concept of what should be, what shouldn't be, but if everybody names it different, you're not going to automate the security. Just a pet peeve of mine here. Yes? They have nice, verbose logs for the servers. It's just a matter of reading them. Again, I don't know of any automated security tools yet that deal with security, really deal with automatic tracking for you. You can write it yourself. I don't know of any, for example, Satan or anything like that, or any other free or commercial tool at this point that does this. I guarantee in a few months everybody will jump on the bandwagon, but... So, any questions or push up? Big question. Standard schema, standard SSL implementation? Standard schema and ACL system is top of my list. Questions or break? Your choice. Somebody in the back. What do you want to know about Active Directory? Is Microsoft's LDAP system, Windows 2000 relies on it heavily. It's got very strong hooks into Kerberos. It seems to work. It has a completely its own different schema. I have quite a bit of experience with that. It's Cisco's bought into it. I've actually worked with the CNSAD. I think everything I know about CNSAD, I'm allowed to talk about at this point. So. But everybody, you have NT, you have Unix, if you're going to be running Solaris, you're probably going to be running the NT version. And then you have this huge wave of, if you're running Solaris, probably run the Netscape version. Then you've got all these NT people coming in, you do a corporate merger, or just somebody else sets another one up. You want to get them to, you want to get them to replicate? You can't.
Subdivide LDAP based on your directory structure and actually have, say, NT managing the internal aspect for your internal company and the rest of it that's exposed on the internet run by Netscape, just for performance reasons. Netscape right now does scale better than than anything else right now.
Like I said, IBM just announced that they're about to release the fastest LDAP server out there. And you have to see it, and when they release it, how long until Netscape does it or anybody else? Questions, answers, go for it.
So that LDAP server allows you to remap for replication?
I use a set of op scripts. Netscape lets you change schema. If you're going to be using multiple servers, you're pretty much better off with someone rewriting your own schema. Pick one, implement it in the other machine, tweak it till the names are correct, pound your head against the wall, stay up all night, eventually it'll work. Nothing says you can't load Netscape schema into Active Directory or vice versa. It's just everybody sees the default scheme that comes with it is different with everyone. And if you try to replicate, if the schemas are different on the machine, the mappings won't work, you can't replicate. That's going to be the big pain. And because the schema is different, your ACLs are different, and life gets bad. I use SED or Perl or something like that. What you do is there's something called LDAP, which basically takes your database, dumps it into a ASCII file, and then you just run a stream editor on that, and then load up your next server when it breaks, find the mistake, correct it. My concerns against PKI is a lot of investment being placed in the big wave right now is PKI, and the basic server underneath PKI is currently being LDAP. And since it's LDAP, it's a very new technology, I'm just a little bit concerned about beta software relying on beta software. I mean, this is, you know, these are odds that pile up against you. Again, like there are already exploits being posted to exploit current servers. So it's not like it's a new secure system. Anything else? Yeah, David. BugTracks has it. Just sort of, I mean, I think I saw 2 or 3 posted to BugTracks in the last couple months, mostly picking on Microsoft. Anything else, sir? Yeah, so those of you complaining about the slides, yes, the slides will be available on the Black Hat website. I'm a person who never really stops writing my slides. I either write them until the last minute, but I apologize. I get complaints every time. Too bad. Again, this is Tom. I'm Peter. We're going to be here all through DEF CON if you have any questions. So thank you for showing up.